good morning, and to everyone. I guess some of us are still stuck in the traffic. When I was developing this talk was all about the conference of IoT. And one of the things is that how do we actually get the IoT, the data that develops and produced by the IoT devices that's able to analyze and get insight into those data. When I was developing these talks, I was thinking about the times that we have gone through. The human race has started off almost a million years ago, where for millions of years, we are in the Stone Age. That is an order of 10 to the power of 6. Then we enter into the age of agriculture. We live there for about 1,000 years. That is in the order of 10 to the power of 3. Then in the 19th century, we enter into the age of industry revolutions. That is a 10 to the power of 2. And over the last few decades, we see tremendous improvement and advancement in technology. From computers to IoT to the internet, and of course now with artificial intelligence. Now, there are already many experts who have spoken about IoT. Everyone will give you some form of projections, one way or another. And there are projections giving you data, that the large amount of data, large amount of objects is going to be connected. But I'm not going to do that because I'm no expert in IoT. But what I can see is that all these devices, in one way or another, is going to be more intelligent. They're going to produce more data, and they are fully connected in one way or another. As a scientist, what my concern is that how are we going to get them connected? How are they going to interact with one another? And how intelligent they are going to be? Now, when I was a kid, and this is one of my favorite cartoons, and basically because I'm a science buff, right? I watched this cartoon. I would like the speed on the spaceships. They're zooming around the city. Robots talking to me, cooking for me, cleaning my dogs, and so forth. There are many, many advances, rather forward-thinking about the cartoon, other than the funny jokes that the cartoon has. Over the last couple of years, we see all sorts of science fictions, Terminators, you know, all sorts of movies that talk about all these science fictions and so forth. Of course, the technology itself, in order for the movie to become popular, they have to somehow plot inside the movie. So it makes that, you know, robots are scary, they're going to take over the world, they're going to, you know, dominate your life, and so forth. But very more importantly is that what is the technology behind it? Those movies actually allow us to have a lot of imaginations. Recently, Google's, just about a year or 2 years ago, Google say that they're going to have a step forward to machine their human-like intelligence. And for those who have watched this movie called Her, of course, the movie is a bit sad because the man actually fall in love with a machine. But we are getting closer and closer to that. And perhaps in the future, we have machines that is able to mimic what our brain is doing. Now, I want to watch you to watch this carefully and listen to this carefully. This Iron Man, Jarvis.
Am I to include the Belgian waffle stand?
That was rhetorical, just show me. Huh. Mark the pavilion's red. Yeah, that's good. Let's do some color coding. Color code every causeway, footpath, tram, restroom, waffle, check everything. And anything with a concrete wall. Ah. Uh-huh. What does that look like to you, Jarvis? Not unlike an atom. In which case, the nucleus would be here. Lose the footpaths. Get rid of them.
What is it you're trying to achieve, sir?
I'm discovering, correction. I'm rediscovering a new element, I believe.
Now, what amazing about that movie is that that is the assistant that I want as a scientist. I'm able to work with a machine that is able to advise me, generate ideas for me, and also at the same time, provide suggestions to me, not just a search machines. Right, so Jarvis is the ultimate engineering assistant. Think of it, if you actually extend that concept to being a lawyer, a nurse, a doctor, an accountant, and whatsoever, that assistant could actually help you to do your work quite tremendously. Now, AI is not new. A lot of us talk about AI, assume it was the things that we invented yesterday. No, it's not. The first neural networks was invented in 1943. It didn't take off. The idea was there. And we enter into two periods of AI winter. Some people argue that it's only one period. Some people argue that there was two. But the thing is that certain technology wasn't available at the point in time, and data wasn't available at the point in time to deliver those kind of promises that the AI scientist has promised. Over the last couple of years, we see tremendous progress. And I'm going to talk about a bit why is it that we see that fast-moving progress. You've already seen that in most of you. You hold a mobile phone. One way or another, some of you have Siri on it, who hold an iPhone, Cortana on some of your devices or Googles and whatsoever. You have some form of assistant already in your hand. You're already augmented in one way or another, right? So let's take a look at what we see. We see that over the last couple of years, there was an amazing rate of improvement. Why this amazing rate? This was in 2012. Jeffrey Hinton, who is now just been appointed as the director for the Vectors Institute in Canada, and his students, Alex, developed something called the AlexNet. The idea is not new. Basically, it's a neural network. It's a different configuration of neural network whatsoever. But what is so important in that work is that it beats all computer vision technology that was developed over the last 20 to 30 years in one single stroke of research. All the work that we've done before that was hitting 74% accuracy, and in one single stroke, he did 84% accuracy. And the rest of them are just simply history. We are now surpassed human accuracy. We have passed less than 3%. Microsoft recently and some other folks has published the new results. But what is important is that it has took off tremendously. These things have been used in image object recognitions, where you recognize whether it's a cat, a dog, whatsoever. More sophisticated, it can be used to recognize scene. When you take a picture, you could recognize where you're from and where you are, whatever. And then not just that, also in terms of style. The technology itself has become more mature. Pinterest is one of them, where you could actually take a picture of and then use that to find where you can buy that product is. There are many other companies that are doing that right now because the technology right now is good enough and mature enough to be used. Of course, there are still things, a lot of things to be improved. Now, when we look at the picture, we don't see just a picture itself, but a segmentation of images, right? There are a lot of images that is all along the way. And what we want to do is to be able to recognize them from different objects. And this is being used in self-driving car. When you do a self-driving car, autonomous vehicle, you want to be able to recognize where the object is, whether it's a car, a human, a cat, a piece of rubbish on the road, where are open space, where the car can move, where the map is, and so forth, so that the car can move intelligently on the road without hitting anyone, hopefully. So this actually prompted many companies to invest heavily, especially almost all the major car industry invest in autonomous car using artificial intelligence in one way or another. It could be just some of them purely cameras, that's what you've seen earlier. Some of them a combination of devices, LIDAR, cameras, some other devices that you can think of. But the important thing is that now the technology allows us actually to do that together with the algorithms. Images is one of them. Voice recognition and translation is the others. When you do something on your Siri, when you do something on your Amazon Echo, when you read it, it has a voice recognition and in some cases able to do translation. There are companies like Baidu, companies like iFlex, Tix in China are doing a lot of all this work. Amazing thing, there was that just a couple of months ago, I was in a conference over in China in the Artificial Intelligence Conference. And while the speaker is speaking, it was a real-time translation, and the things was all written on the screen in real time. Unfortunately, I do not able to demonstrate here because I do not have a direct connections to iFlex technology right now. But this is what they are doing. And in many simple cases, you can do that. Taking on the next steps is to do natural language processing. You have language that you're able to translate, your picture you're able to recognize, but you want the context to it. For example, a picture like this on the top of the right-hand corner, left-hand corner, and you see a little girl that is jumping. And what you want to do is that it's not just recognize that there's a girl, but you want to know that the girl is jumping. And also the dog is jumping over the pole. And that's what you want to do, right? At least in a single shot frame. But thinking of it is extending that into videos where some of the technology you can see on the floor is that then you are able to start to understand what the videos are doing or the person are doing. That allows you to do anomaly detection, odd behavior detections, and so forth. Combining it with natural language processing, it's a very, very powerful technology. But of course, we're still making mistakes. There are simple mistakes like this where the baby was being mistaken for things like this. But anyway, let's move on. I want to show you the research that's done by Facebook.
Yes.
What is the man doing?
Typing.
Is the baby sitting on his lap?
Yes.
Are they smiling?
Yes.
Is there a baby in the photo?
Yes.
Where is the baby standing?
Bathroom.
What is the baby doing?
Brushing teeth.
Now, that Facebook's technology, is still not available right now. Is basically the combination of different technology that allows you to actually look at the picture and ask questions about it, right? The machine itself were able to analyze the picture and then give a context of what the picture is all about. Now, the AI itself is not just in the retail space or what you see, the voice recognition, but it helps in the areas of medicine. In a couple of this, at the moment right now, there is a lot of efforts in using artificial intelligence to help in the healthcare area. Path AI is one of them. And I just want to show you examples of why is it pretty useful. Now, this is what a doctor will see when he gets the biopsies. And it is pretty difficult for us laymen to actually understand what this is all about. Even for an expert or a doctor, this is pretty challenging. Many of times, they make mistakes. In fact, in the breast biopsies, is that they make they have a concordia of about 75%. And then in some other cases, it's less than 50%. So what they have, what BS Path IT is that they have done is that they have actually do a using a convolutional neural networks to train it. Training the network itself, obtain the optimized parameters, and then able then to help to predict it very accurately. So this is what in a clinical workflow is like. And you can see that the accuracy has improved tremendously. So you see that many others, hospital, company, is springing up to develop all this new technology using artificial intelligence or machine learning or deep learning in one way or another to advance and help doctors to find medical care, medical cure faster. So these are just a couple of examples, and NIH, which is another company, another institute, they are doing this. Now, because of that, NVIDIA are partnering with Department of Energy, NCI, to build an AI platform called Cancer Research. Now, cancer, there are still a lot of questions about cancers, and we are still pretty far away from curing all of them. But we believe that with the help of artificial intelligence, we could actually help to accelerate the research and able to find a cure for certain diseases. And the whole idea is to accelerate discovery of cancer therapies, to predict drug response, and also automate the analysis of some of the treatment effectiveness. This is what the whole platform is all about using AI. As you guys would know, that a lot of us, our machine, whether is it in our aircraft, turbine, or even our car right now, is all heavily electronics. You have sensors in your car all over. How do we actually make use of those sensors is yet to be found out. But in companies like General Electric, they have actually used the information they've gotten, applied neural networks to detect abnormality inside the engine. Now, this is basically to find out whether the engine will fail, not that the engine has failed. The engine will fail in certain point in time. So it's sort of a prediction. Now, previously, we say that, well, previously, it can already be done. Yes, it's already been done. You have to come up with some complex mathematical formulas and to find that out using statistical methods and mathematical methods. But there are certain cases where it's almost impossible to detect. One of the things is that the neural networks, with the advance of neural network and other form of neural networks, we are able to actually train those networks and detect those abnormally easily. So this is examples of it. This is what you see being reported. You could actually find that in open source. The paper was being published. And you could see that the red dots show that they have improved tremendously. Now, I'm going to just, and this is another example of United Technology. I'm going to move a bit quicker over here because we have limited amount of time. Now, those are passive. When I say passive, is that you ask certain things, it predicts for you, and so forth. What about generative? We go to the next level of artificial intelligence. Intelligent machines are is taking over the expert. This is where we train a neural network to actually take in all the arts of those artists. The neural network learned about the strokes, the style, how the painting is like, and what you do is that you put a picture into it and you generate out the photos according to the style of the thing. For example, like Monet, Van Gogh, Picasso, or whatsoever. And these are the examples of it. I just want to show it to you. This is Scream. And then what you have is that you have this guy, and we took a picture of it and generated out a picture that is, the style is pretty similar to it. And this is pretty generative, right? Another thing is this. You have a text, a suggestion, saying that, well, I want a bird that is with blue and white and with a very short beak. The first row, we develop a picture of how the birds look like. The second stage, perfect the picture. And this is, in the future, what you're going to see. Basically, the idea is that you suggest something through your voice, through your text, or through whatsoever. And the computer will generate out the image that you think that you want.
What if you could come up with thousands of options for a single design without drawing, all of which meet specific goals set by the designer? And from those options, pick the one design that delivers on the most important criteria, the design you couldn't possibly have imagined. This is generative design, a technology that harnesses massive computing power, creating forms with precise amounts of material only where needed, achieving maximum performance while wasting nothing. But generative design can be about much more than simply turning out alternatives. Prototypes can be scanned and equipped with sensors that provide real-time performance data that can be looped back into the design process, so the object, in effect, co-designs itself. And depending on the material and method of manufacture chosen, the software can optimize the design for those choices. In its search for the optimal design, generative design creates complex forms that would otherwise be impossible to make using traditional manufacturing methods. Now, with advancements in material science and the ability of 3D printers to print metal, companies like Airbus can create forms like this airplane partition panel that's half as light and just as strong. The result? Significant reduction in fuel costs and CO2 emissions. The things that have limited us in the past, software, materials, manufacturing, no longer do so. With generative design, the world can look and perform any way we want it to. This is the next stage in the evolution of design, and it's happening now.
This is the technology that created by Autodesk called Dreamcatcher. And basically, it uses artificial intelligence to generate ideas. Previously, when as a designer, when you sit in front of a workstation, you design whatever things that you think that you want. You put a bit here and there once in a while because your brain tells you to actually change here a little bit here and there. But what Dreamcatcher does is that it produces all the different options. It generates ideas for you. And then from there, you actually pick what you think is most optimal for your design. This is the future of design using artificial intelligence. Like I say again, Maxon will be one of the major use for this to predict what are the next Maxon is going to be used. And this is one example of it where they actually develop, or rather simulate molecules that's able to fit into a peptide. This is not a human thing. Well, for a human to do it, it takes a pretty long time. But for machines to actually generate different ideas on how things can be fit into from a molecule to another molecule, this is the ways the computer can do it pretty easily using artificial intelligence. So AI is driving a new discovery in drugs and so forth. We will see that tremendously. A lot of this new news that's coming out in the next couple of years. We're still in the area of, remember the movie I showed to you about Jarvis. Jarvis is not just about predictive. It's not just generative. but it's intuitive and it's self-learning. Intuitive is that, remember the last part of the clips that I showed to you, is that Jarvis asked Tony about what are you trying to do? And so that Jarvis could actually help the machines, help Tony to actually come up with new ideas or so forth. And this is intuitive and self-learning AI. Remember the first games of tic-tac-toe? This is the very first machine, just for this. And then over in the glass, in 1997, you have Deep Blue beating Kasparov in chess. And then, of course, you have then, recently, you have Watson beating human in Jeopardy. And the most recently is a company that is in Cambridge called DeepMind, currently now is part of Google's AI lab that work on general AI technology. They have been working a lot in something what we call reinforcement learning. This is, again, not a new idea. It's just that now, with the amount of computing power and amount of data that we have, these algorithms now become implementable and trackable. They published a paper called The Human Control Through Deep Reinforcement Learning. I'm not going to talk about the paper too much, but I want you just to watch the next movie. This is an Atari game. Now, this game, remember that this game has not played Atari before. This machine has not played Atari before. It just knows that the rules and it knows the objective. That's all that it knows. After 10 minutes of training, this is what will happen. It is pretty clumsy, right? It doesn't do very well. So you can see over here. Then you go through 120 minutes of training. You must remember this thing, that this thing has not played Atari before. It became an expert in just under 2 hours. And finally, it was trained for 240 minutes. It surpassed human capability. So this is what this algorithm is able to do. Now, like I say again, the algorithm is this thing is not something that is complicated. This is basically a neural network, what we call Q neural network. And it is not a database. The whole thing was encapsulated within these few equations. And these equations actually determine on how the game or the machine should play the games. That's all. Of course, it is much more complex. It's not as trivial as what I've explained, but it is not as complex as one would actually think of. Very important thing that it is not a database. It's not that you store all the different moves. It's actually encapsulated within a small set of equations. And what we do is that we train that equations to be optimized in optimum way, and it will learn how to play the game. That technology moves on to where we see AlphaGo is. Now, AlphaGo, unlike chess, AlphaGo has almost an infinite numbers of moves, right? The numbers of billions of stars in the planets in this universe is less than the number of moves in Go game. But what the DeepMind guys have done was that they used the same technology that I mentioned earlier, together with some other new technology, what we call Monte Carlo search tree, that's enabled us to actually to play Go game. The amazing thing about this Go game is that it beats the world champion by 4-1, as you guys would know. Now, on game number 3 itself, there was a most interesting game itself. is that AlphaGo make a move that all experts at a point in time thought that AlphaGo make a very extremely silly move on game number three. However, from retrospect, after AlphaGo won the game, when the expert reanalyzed the game, that was a move, a very, very profound move that AlphaGo has made. And no expert in the world has actually seen that move before. And that's how AlphaGo has become imaginative, has become creative. Now, this is a poker game. AlphaGo is a man, AlphaGo is a machine against man. Poker game, again, is a machine against man with random information. When you draw a card, it's random. But what is interesting over here is that the poker game, the machine itself, beat the top four players by a large margin, right? After playing about 120,000 hands. On average, every hand, the game won about $14. So machine right now is able to play against human, and this is, again, this is one of the tests that how machine has progressed on to actually be better than human being. Of course, people, forget about this thing. But what I want to talk to you about is that another thing is that someone in Canada, University of Alberta and the Czech Republic have come out with another new algorithms to play poker. And what they have done is that they actually combine reinforcement learning together with a very deep learning technology that's allowed ones to play. It doesn't go through a lot of trainings, of course, huge amount of training. And then you're able to string the neural networks down to a laptop and able to play the game against the top player poker. Again, the machine won that technology. How can it be applied? One of the things was robotics. As you can see over here, this is how a robot actually moves. Oh, you may think that this is easy. We human walk easily. We walk and whatsoever. But to program a robot to walk is a very, very tough thing to do. It is what we call an inverse pendulum problem. And it could be a double or triple inverse pendulum problem. And this is very challenging. And what I want to show you is this. What if we can teach machine to actually learn to do things by itself? This is examples of in Berkeley, robots. Now, this robot's task is to put the things into the small little hole, right? Now, it didn't program on how to do it. It just was told that it has to do it. So the robots will keep on attending, trial and error. And this is after a lot of trial and error, it learns by itself. So we are beginning to make robots that starts to learn by itself. And in order to accelerate the learning, this is where we can actually line up tens, hundreds, and thousands of robots, each of them robots all learning in one way or another. And then what we do is what we call transfer learning and transfer the knowledge from one robot to the next robots. And then again, we can build a pretty much improved robots itself. So this is a project that is done by one of the company that actually has autonomous robots that are building a bridge across a river. Together with the generative technology, together with the intuitions and the self-learning technology, they can build robots to build a bridge without human intervention. This is where we are right now. And these are examples that in Amsterdam, this is one of the projects they are doing. So we are seeing people that are building AI to build AI. We are seeing robots that build robots. This is the phenomenon that we are seeing right now. So why AI and machine learning doable right now? Well, big data is available. The IoT devices, the sensors devices, the cameras, the smartphone, whatever, produce lots and lots of data. Facebook itself has 350 million images a day. That's allowed us to actually train our neural network to recognize images. And many other forms of data has become available. The compute power is now available too. NVIDIA, ourselves, who produce cards for in the gaming space, has able to turn the GPU into a compute horsepower. And then there are new techniques, like I mentioned before, the techniques which like reinforcement learning, convolutional neural networks, and so forth. Don't worry about this equation, but what I want to impress on you is that to train one model, it takes about 10 to 100 hexaflops, right? And that is basically one model. In most of the time, you require to run thousands of models to train because you would change the parameters here and so forth. This is basically a development cycle. So just to give examples, this is a very old network, 10 layers to do image recognitions. It takes you about 30 GPU days to actually train the network. So basically, if you have a GPU, it takes you 30 days to actually train the network. So that is only a 10 layers. As time goes by, over the last couple of years, we're building networks that is bigger and bigger. Just in 2015, we have a network by Microsoft that is 152. It's called ResNet. Now we have networks that is in terms of thousands. So imagine the compute power that is needed. The amount of data available is also humongous. Like voice itself, Baidu has just, this is data that's a couple of years ago, has almost 6,000 to 7,000 hours of voice to actually get trained. And again, so that is required of compute power. AlphaGo, the training of their neural network, takes about 3 weeks to train the network. They take about 340 million training steps on 50 GPUs. And you could see that they have a distributed version, single version, and so forth. But what I'm trying to point is that it takes a lot of compute power to train it. So we need to build new AI centers, right? Centers that's able to do scale-up training, influence, and also then we can actually string those networks to bring it into a devices like a robots. The ecosystem is important. There are already a lot of ecosystems available, like Cafe, Tiano, and so forth. So we know that those networks, those frameworks are available. We can develop neural networks easily right now. We do not have to actually go back to the rudimentary programming languages like C or C++, but we already have frameworks that allow us to produce, write, and produce AI frameworks easily. NVIDIA, of course, with NVIDIA technology, we're developing specialized technology in order to accelerate AI computing. Remember that it takes a very long time to actually train those networks. We're actually building systems that allow us to run those networks very, very quickly. Together with our partners, IBM, and so forth, we're also developing new technology that's allowed the GPU to actually connect to them and run those networks very, very fast. Integrated into the stack itself, we have things like the software stacks. And for those who are interested in it, can talk to my colleagues over here to understand the entire stacks better. But this is something called what we call DGX. We built a big system within NVIDIA. It consists of 120 of these servers. Each of them have 8 GPU. For our AI researcher to do research and developing new algorithms on AI. Our partners, people like Facebook, is building systems, specialized systems for their AI research, things like the Big Sur server, the Facebook Big Basin, and then Microsoft, the Project Olympus, right? All configuring the systems in one way or another to accelerate those algorithms that is to run faster so that training can take a shorter time. So this is Project Olympus. I just want to give you a schematic diagrams. Don't worry about it too much. You'll see that on the public website. What NVIDIA is doing also is to actually develop technology underlying the library to actually accelerate those frameworks on our platform easily. You do not need to know about GPU to run, to do AI. You develop your AI on top of the framework. The GPUs and the library itself will actually accelerate those computations. So the new era of computing is here. We are now into the age of AI and IoT. And I want you to walk away. This is just newly released just about 2 days ago. This is from Australia, from NDIS. This is the avatar, and it is a chatbot. So take a look at this.
Hello. My name is Nadia. I'm a virtual assistant, and I'm here to help you. I'm not human, but I can make it easier for you and other NDIS users to get the information and help you need. You have more important things to do than wait on the phone, so I'm here to help whenever you need. I can hear you, and if you have a webcam, I can see you too. You can talk to me or type questions in the chat box, and I will talk back and write my answers. This is so I can help people with all different kinds of disabilities. NDIS users like you have tested me along the way and helped make me what I am today. So far, they really like me, which is great. I won't be able to answer every question yet because I'm still learning what answers people are looking for. Helping people access the NDIS is very important, so thank you for helping train me by asking me questions so I can get better at my job. I appreciate your patience. I'm a good listener, and I really want to understand you better. So please tell me what you want to know about the NDIS and how I can improve. I like it when you're honest. Go on, ask me something. If you don't like talking to me, you can ask to speak to a real person. But I hope you'll come back and talk to me again soon. Why don't you ask me what the NDIS is?
So with that, thank you very much.